Hello everyone and welcome to the One Stop Co-op Shop. Today we're going to do a playthrough of Darkrock Ventures by Magic Meeple Games. This game was kickstarted maybe about a year ago almost. It is generally a competitive game. However, during the Kickstarter they came up with solo or co-op rules, and I will tell you, they are not the greatest rules in the world. There's a lot left to the imagination. It's okay, it's not terrible, but what I'm going to do today is take my best interpretation of the rules. I looked on Board Game Geek, I put out some questions to the designer. I think this is a good way to play. So I'm playing solo. I'm going to use two mining stations, or two mining companies. I think that's the best way to do it as a solo game. If it's co-op, just think of it with two different people playing the two different stations. So, just like normal, this video, I'm going to show you guys how to set up the game, a little bit about the board, what you're seeing on here. There's lots of little things to look at here. So I'm going to go through all of those in detail, all the different stations on here, how you win and lose, all of that. If you already know that, or you don't really care and you just want to see the playthrough, just check out the second video in the playthrough, in the playlist, and you will see the playthrough, and you can see how the game is played. Alright, so thank you very much for watching. So what we have here is a player board. So I'm going to be using two, but they're both completely identical. There is no special abilities in this game, dependent on who you are. So each player board is identical, except for the color, just to denote who you are. So on this board, there's a couple different things to look at. The first is up here. These are kind of cool. They're like little bunkers. This is for your crew members. You're going to start with three basic crew members with the option of being able to purchase a fourth as well as purchasing a captain. So that's what these two are, but you won't start with those, so I'll take them off. You also start with one rig die. So you'll be using this rig die to try and pair with the dice that are on the board, the mining dice or the neutronium dice, to be able to get numbers so that you can mine the specific metals that you need in order to win the game. You start out with just one rig die, but you can have up to three. How you get more is by having more money. So the more money you have at the beginning of the round, the more rig dice you'll have. So if you're at 10 or more, for money, you can have two dice. If you're at 20 or more, you can have three rigged dice. And of course, the more rigged dice that you have, the more potential you have at pairing dice together to make numbers to mine more metal. So, of course, you want to get more of these as soon as possible. Same with the workers. The more workers you have, the more you can place on the board. Over here, what you have down here is where you're going to place your mined metals. So you start with only three open areas. I cannot have more than three different metals here before I have to export them for cash. If I try and collect more than that, I just can't even pick it up. What I have to do is pay money to get more cargo space. Excuse me. And so you can do that with an action on the board, which I'll show you. Or you can, that's the only way you can do that, but then once you move this up, you can actually hold more metals, and you can go all the way to having six if you really want it. So that's the player board. I'll be using one for each color, one for green, one for blue. Like I said, they're totally identical. What is kind of cool is on the back, you have a heck of a lot of details, but this is your player aid. It looks teeny, teeny, tiny, and that's because it is. It's very small. So if you have a hard time reading, you're going to need your reading glasses. I will tell you that. Heck, I need reading glasses almost, and I have 20/20 vision. So this just kind of helps you for a player aid. And you can even use this side, because look, they even have the spots right here, which is kind of cool that they did that. I just wish it was a little bigger. It's so gosh darn small, but that's okay. All right, so you can use this side of the board if you want it. All right, next let's just talk about the board for a second, just so you guys can see, because there's lots of little things here. There are tons of different stations, and I want to make sure you understand what's going on. So first, on the outside here, that is your money track. There are two pretty cool little tiny dollar signs that you'll be using to track your money for each individual mining company. So since I have two, I have the blue and the green. Now, technically, on the normal mode, you're supposed to start at $10 for the co-op. However, at $10, you're supposed to have two rigged dice, and in the rules, they say to start with one rigged die. So what I have done is I'm just going to start each one at 9. Okay? Technically, that's not right, but I think that makes more sense. I have to at least earn $1 to be able to get my second rig die. I think it makes sense. Normal rules. If you want to play at harder versions, you'll actually go down to even less money. That is insane, by the way. Good luck ever winning that. Okay, so what we have here are different stations. So there are stations on the outside of the board, and then there's the actual mining locations. There are two for each type of metal. And then there's also the solar array over here to collect solar power that you can sell, and neutronium over here, which you can get by failing to mine anything else. So what you're going to be doing is you'll be placing your meeples in different areas to use their abilities, okay? So if I have my meeples over here, I'm trying to pair to get, a 10. So if I can get 10 with two dice, then I'm able to take one of these metal pieces, okay? So that's how the board is set up. You'll be placing your meeples across the board, either in the solar array, these different stations, or these mining areas. And then these dice will be rolled at the beginning of the round. So I'm going to go through each one in detail. All right, so we're going to first start at the cargo station. So here there's two different spots you can place one of your meeples. You can place it here, and you just essentially get to increase your cargo space by one. You don't have to pay anything. You're just using up a meeple for that round, but you get to do that for free. Or you can put your dude or meeple in the cargo hold plus. You have to pay $1, but then you can actually increase your cargo hold by two. Now, there is a possibility of obtaining a captain. Okay, he's a bigger meeple. Just you can kind of see, compare the difference. Captains can get you some special abilities. So if I place him, the captain, right here, because he is more expensive and he's your captain, he actually will increase your cargo hold by two for free, or he'll increase it by four for $1. Pretty cool. So you have to pay to get your captain, but if you do, your captain is going to be helpful in all these different locations a little bit differently, and I'll go into that as we go through this. The next spot is the solar array. So what you're going to do at the beginning of the round is you can place your meeple here. And then as long as they don't get attacked by the Theron invaders, during the action phase, you'll move them up one. And then what you can do is, instead of moving them up one, you can actually take that meeple off, and whatever level they're at, you can claim one of these solar array resources. And then you can sell that for $3 a piece back to Earth. However, if you have your captain here, okay, he's bigger, he will get double whatever's here. So if the captain is at 2 and you decide to pull him off, he'll give you 4 solar array power. However, don't forget, there's only a total of 6 of these, and they are limited. So if all 6 are taken, you cannot go and export more of them. So that's just something to be careful of. All right, so now we're looking at the rigs. So if I place my individual meeple here on the rig rental, I get to roll one additional rig die. Now, I can only do that if I'm not using all 3 of my rig dice already, because I cannot roll a 4th one. You only have a total of 3. But if I'm rolling only 1 or 2, I can place a meeple there to roll an additional one. The rig mod lets you use 2 of your rig dice to actually pair, instead of having to use 1 rig die and 1 mining or neutronium die. Okay, so that's something that's kind of nice. You could use both your dice instead. So that's how the rig modification works. If I use the rig reboot, that allows me to re-roll one of my rig dice. If I'm only rolling 1 die, I just get to re-roll it once. Or if I'm rolling multiple dice, I can decide which one I want to re-roll and re-roll it. So that's the rig reboot area. And that's the whole rigs station. All right, let's talk next about the export station. This is how you're going to make money. This is incredibly important. It's very important that, especially during this co-op game, you're getting exports as soon as possible to get money, because you're going to run out of money really quick. And you'll see why. So if I place my individual meeple on this spot, I can export 1 resource. If I'm in here, that would be 2 resources. If I'm here, 3 resources. And then down here, it tells you how much you make for each type of resource. So the red, which is the neutronium, is only worth $1. And how you get that, and I'll explain this when we get up there, but you get that only by failing to mine anything else. So if you don't mine anything else, you get the Natronium resource. That's why it's pretty cheap. Solar energy is $3 a pop. The orange, which is iron, is $4 a pop. The cobalt, which is blue, is $6 a pop. And the white, which is platinum, is $8 a pop. So depending on how much you are exporting, you'll get these dollar amounts for that. All right, up here we have the crew station. So there's three different crew stations. This one is a recruit crew station. If I put a meeple here, I've sent somebody into this station to go and recruit another meeple. I can pay $3 to get my fourth regular meeple, so I'd get a second or a fourth regular meeple, or I can pay $5 to get my captain. Okay, you can place a guy there and get that benefit. You can also sell or release a crew member. That's just to get more money. Now, you'll hardly ever see that in the co-op mode. I mean, I've never done that. I think that's much more for the competitive game, because at the end, it's whoever has the most money. So you might, when you're getting close to the end, just want to sell out your meeples or your crew members because you don't need them. You can also just subcontract, just place a meeple here, and you get $1 for the round. So it's just a way to make quick money. And the difference for the captain here is he will make 2 money. Woohoo! So not a great use of your captain if you have a captain, but still something you could do. He gets $2 because he is cool. All right, Neutronium. I know I already kind of talked a little bit about this, but Neutronium you're only going to get if you fail to mine any of the metals during the round, but you have to have somebody actually in the mine area. So if you don't have anybody in the mine area, you're not going to get Neutronium. But if I tried to have somebody collect some cobalt or iron or platinum and I failed, I'll be able to collect one of these. They're only worth $1, so they're not very beneficial that way. But what they can do is you can use these to re-roll this Neutronium die. Each round you're going to roll this black Neutronium die, and you can use that to pair with your rig dice to be able to actually mine specific metals. So you can use one of these to re-roll that die. Really, really helpful. However, in the co-op mode, that also pushes you to losing the game, and you'll see that in a little bit. But you can use Neutronium to reroll the die. You can also use any metal to help when the Thuron Marauders attack. You can use them to prevent having to have your meeple flee. And I'll show you that in a sec. All right, next we have the gear station. This station is very, very, very important. So what you can do with a gear station is you've got 4 different locations. Here, you can change one of your, regular meeple. You can use rough imaging, which allows you to change one of your rig dice by a +3 or a -3. And what's great about that +3, -3 is you can even go negative. So let's say I roll a 2 on my rig die. I can change that to a -1. And then if I pair that with my, with one of the mining dice, like this 5, that would be a -1, and that would be a 5, so I'd have a 4. And with that, I'd be able to actually mine some cobalt, which is pretty cool. So that is pretty nice, the rough imaging. Precision imaging is the same, it's just a +1, -1. Vortex drill lets you take your die and flip it to the opposite side. Now, and that's only your rig die that you can do that. The rover is pretty cool. The rover actually lets you collect from an adjacent mining location. So when we look at the mines, you'll see that they're kind of in a circle. And so if I'm on the 12 spot, I can actually use the rover to collect from 10 or 2, which is pretty cool. So that's really helpful. That's the gear area. All right, this spot is the leader and delegate area. So you're not going to see this often in the co-op game. But normally, whoever is a leader gets to go first, placing their meeples, and so there's somewhat of a benefit of that, because if I place a meeple here, then your teammate, or during the competitive game, your competitors can't place their meeple on that spot because you are blocking it. So leader, if you place your meeple there, you become the leader and you get to place your meeples first. Delegate is actually a really cool one, and I've actually used it a couple times, even for the co-op mode. So normally, like I just said, you can only have your meeple on a specific spot, but I could place one meeple if, let me grab my green ones, I could place my green meeple here in this delegate spot, and then immediately place another meeple on a spot that has a blue individual or another team or another competitor or even another teammate. And then we could both get that benefit. Now, the leader, you can't do that, but you could do that with the mining spots, or you could do that with the gear for the rough imaging or precision imaging. That's pretty cool. Now, this research deck is completely optional. However, I like playing with it because it's just another thing that you can place a meeple on. So during your turn, you can place a meeple here on the research spot. And what that means is during the action phase, you can grab one of these three research abilities, and that becomes your ability for the rest of the game. You can always come here and grab another research card, but then you have to discard the one that you're on. If you don't like any of these three, but you still want to get a research ability, you can also just have these three cards discarded, draw three new ones from here, and then you have to pick one of those three new ones. That's another spot you can place your meeple to grab a research ability. And just so you guys can see these research abilities, because these are the ones I'm going to use, we have subcontract negotiations. Once per turn, double the amount of credits collected by one of your meeples or captains when using the subcontract station. So when you use that subcontract, you get $2 or even $4. Then we have the iron particle regeneration. Once per turn, when exporting the iron, you may return up to 2 iron resource tokens back to the board instead of removing them from the game. Collection is $3 for each that's exported this way instead of the regular 4. And then the last one is this subparticle teleportation. Once per turn, you may export 1 resource token automatically without using the export station. For $1 less than its normal value. Oh, that is sweet. I might actually pick that up, because that means you don't have to place an individual in that export spot, and you can still export it. Even if it's for $1 less, it's still money. And in this game, money is key. So during the game, there is, of course, something that is attacking the players during the co-op mode. You can also use this during the competitive mode, but it's optional. You have to use it for the co-op or solo mode. And that's the Theron Marauders. I don't know how to say that. Each round, what you're going to do is, for each player that's playing, so since I'm playing with 2 stations, I'm going to have 2 cards that I'm going to have to draw. However, based on the rules, it's iffy on when you're supposed to draw it. What I do is at the beginning of each of your turns. So if I'm blue that's going first, I'll draw 1 card, and then green will go, and green will draw 1 card before they play theirs, but it's after blue is played. So blue, whoever's the first player, gets a benefit because they only have 1 Theron Marauders card that's going to be flipped before they get to resolve their meeples, versus the second player will have to have 2 cards flipped. Now, what these cards are going to look like is they're going to have different stations that they're attacking, okay? You can kind of see that in these cards. So wherever these Theron Marauders are attacking, you have an option. If you have a meeple there, you can flee. That meeple will run away from that spot. So let's say the meeple was in, this is the rover spot. So let's say my meeple was in the rover spot. I can just move him out of there, and then I will place a damage token on the rover location and, what is this called? The vortex drill. So I'm doing it on the card just because it's easier to show you, but it'll be on the board itself. You'll put these damage tokens. Or if you don't want to do that, what you can do is you can actually pay one of any of your iron or neutronium dice to block the Theron invaders. So let's say I had this solar energy on my character sheet. I can give that up, and then that would block the Theron Marauders from making us remove our meeples. However, there is one thing to note. If you use the neutronium to shield yourself, you actually have to increase this neutronium track, which means it's going to be sooner until you lose. So what's important is if you're using a shield and you're not using the neutronium, you're fine. You can just use any of the regular metals. So that would be the iron, the platinum, or the cobalt. You can get rid of any of those, or you can also get rid of this neutronium, but if you do, you're going to increase the neutronium track. Okay, there is one card in here. Let's see if I can find it. It is the best card in the world. It is Calm Before the Storm. When that's played, you just reshuffle the deck, and you did not have an attack during that round. Awesome. So this board is only used in the co-op or solo mode. What you're trying to do is, the objective of the game in the solo or co-op is to be able to get three of the platinum medals. Is that what it's called? I always forget the names. Yep, platinum medals. 1, 2, 3, 4 of the cobalt, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of the iron. You need to export that, all of that, before you lose the game, okay? And how you're going to lose the game is two ways. One, this neutronium track gets all the way to here. By the way, I've never lost that way. The other way you can lose is, you see these destruction tokens. When you need to place your fifth one, because you can see there's only four here, the fifth one is on this neutronium track. When you need to place your fifth destruction token and you can't, you lose the game. Now you may be asking, well, how do you get these? Well, what happens when you have those Theron Invader cards? Whenever they attack, you're going to be placing a damage icon, as long as it's not shielded, on the actual board. Once you run out of these damage tokens, the next location that they hit, so let's say, for an example, I've used up all of my damage tokens, so these are no longer here. I then flipped this export lockdown card from the Theron Marauders. Instead of putting one of these orange ones that have been used up, they're on the board somewhere else, I have to place this destroyed icon on the board in that specific location. That now is completely destroyed. I can never use it the rest of the game. Okay? Now, if there was any damage tokens on this before, so let's say it was this spot was damaged 3 times before this, and I still have none of these damage tokens left in the supply, well then I would take this destruction token, put it here, and then take these 3 damage tokens, and they go back into supply. So now I have more supply for having damage in the future. But if then these are used up and I draw another Marauder card like this one, the Solar Strike, then the solar area is destroyed. And now I have 2 spots that have used these destruction tokens, and I only have 2 left. If these 2 are placed and I need to place another one, I lose the game. Now, how I get rid of these damage tokens is by placing my meeple on that specific location that's damaged, and then wherever this neutronium track is, I have to immediately pay that amount of dollars to be able to repair it. If I can't repair it, I can't place my meeple there. So, for an example, let's say I wanted to place my meeple on the solar array, but there were 2 damage tokens on the solar array. I could place my meeple there and immediately repair it, and then I have to look here. Well, I'm only at the $1 level, so I had to pay $2 to repair that. However, if this was down at, like, let's say the 6th level, I'd have to pay $12 to get rid of these 2 damage tokens. But then they go back to supply and they can be helped, and they can help us. Now, how this neutronium track works is, every time a Theron Marauder attacks, this increases by 1. So any of these cards is considered an attack, except for the Calm Before the Storm card. If you ever flip that card, you do not have to increase the neutronium track, which I love. I love this card. It needs to show up all the time, which it doesn't. Usually it's at the bottom of the deck. But otherwise, if you think about it, each round, this is going to increase at a minimum of 2, okay? So very quickly, it's going to get expensive. And then if you use any of that neutronium to either reroll the neutronium die or as a shield, that also is going to increase this track. So all of a sudden, it's going to get very, very expensive very quickly to repair any of the damaged locations. So that's the neutronium track, and that's how you win or lose the game. We have all of the mining areas. You can place a meeple on any of these areas, and then what you're going to try and do is pair dice. So pair any of these, the 2 mining dice or the neutronium die, with one or with one of your rig dice. So let's say I rolled these two rig dice. Let's say I rolled them and I got a 6 and a 6. Okay, so, and I had my meeple here. Well, 6 and a 4 is 10. So I've used this rig die, but then I get to collect this, what is this, platinum? No, this is cobalt. So obtain one of these cobalt resources, okay? Now, these are all finite. So once these are all gone, they're gone forever. I can no longer mine that area. So as you can see, there is the least amount of the platinum and the most of the iron, okay? Also, you'll find that the iron is the easiest to get because there's 6s and 8s that you need to pair. The cobalt is a little bit harder, but the platinum's really hard. You have to get a 12 or a 2. The 2, you have to have one of these at a 1, or you have to use your rough imaging or precision imaging, stuff like that. So that's what you're going to be doing. You're going to be placing your meeples on here. And just like before, I can't place two different stations in the same mining location. However, I can place two of my characters or meeples in the same location. That's fine. You can have multiples there. But if I have two there, that means I'm going to have to use two rig dice to collect two. However, if you use your captain, your captain can use one rig die to collect two resources of a type. Okay, last but certainly not least is just how, I just want to show you guys the order, how the order of this game works. So first what's going to happen is you roll your mining dice. There'll be these two. You'll know what those numbers are, so I've got a 6 and a 4. Then each player, starting with the leader, gets to start placing their meeples on the board. So we'll just kind of randomly plot these here, okay? Then, after that, the first player will go and draw one Theron Marauder card and then place damage tokens or destruction tokens there if need be and increase the Neutronium track if there was an actual attack. Then, what they'll do is player one, so we're going to just say player one is green, will then roll their rig dice. And then they can try and pair using their abilities and what they have. So 6 and a 4 is a 10. Great, collected one of these. So on and so forth. Maybe I exported so I get some money. Move up and down the track. Then second player will draw another Theron Marauder card and do the same thing. After that, then that's the end of the round. And we'll re-roll the mining dice and do this again, and we'll do it again until we either win by collecting enough resources or we lose by needing to be placed the fifth destruction token or just run out on the Neutronium track. Whew, that is a lot to explain. The game is pretty quick, lots of explanation because there's lots of different places you can put your little meeples. So hope you guys enjoy the playthrough and thanks for watching.